Welcome to The Genuine Fake. I'm Patricia Kingori, Associate Professor of Sociology and Global Health Ethics at the Wellcome Centre for Ethics and Humanities at the University of Oxford. I'm Principal Investigator of a large Wellcome Trust-funded project examining fakes, fabrications and falsehoods in health and medicine. One of the concepts I'm looking at is the genuine fake, the idea that something can be real and fake at the same time. I came across this idea when I started to do some work looking at fabricated data. Most of my works looked at field workers, people who collect data for clinical trials. They talk about this idea of things being both real and fake. When they fabricate data, they often spend more time fabricating data than actually collecting it properly. They would know their participants so well that they wouldn't even need to go to ask them questions. They would be able to guess, often accurately, what their responses would be. One of the things I found really fascinating was when there have been surveys, I've gone back and looked at the data that's been fabricated by these field workers in this way. They've found actually the margin of error to be very small. More often than not, these field workers get the responses right. Pollsters often will be able to tell from looking at the outside of someone's house what kind of person lives inside the house. If you speak to car salesmen, they'll be able to tell you about their clients even before that person's opened their mouth. This Wellcome Trust funded project is looking at fakes, fabrications and falsehoods in global health, trying to make sense of two particular areas, knowledge production and drugs and medicines, looking at the people, the processes and the places involved in these concerns around fakes in the UK and also Southeast Asia and Africa. Knowledge production is really looking at what's involved in producing knowledge, so looking at the publications and a growing phenomenon known as predatory journals. A famous librarian, John Beale, produced a list of what he thought were fake journals, which he called predatory journals. And these have been seen to increase by 800% in the last 5 years. So we're in a situation now where we've got all of these journals. Nobody knows whether they're real or fake. So where do you publish? The various types of articles in the journals, some of them actually pay to be in the journals, and that's where the notion of these journals being fraudulent comes from. Academics across the globe who aren't aware that there isn't the British Journal of X are paying to publish in these journals because they see them as prestigious, and those journals will be publishing on all sorts of things. Most academics will tell you they will have received an email saying, "Dear Professor so-and-so, could you publish in my journal?" Most of us are aware of which are the real and the fake journals, but if you're in a very isolated institution, you're not tapped into the critical mass of academics, it might be very difficult for you to distinguish what's a real and a fake journal. The other area I'm looking at is the growing field of shadow scholars. These are people who write and publish articles and journals, theses, essays for other people. Working closely with the Oxford Internet Institute, it's become apparent that Nairobi is a kind of epicenter of where these shadow scholars exist. So my work will be spending time really trying to understand what are the pathways into shadow scholarship? Why would someone choose this line of work? How do they manage to make a living from this kind of work? And what does it actually mean for what we understand to be knowledge production if we have a growing number of people who write essays and articles for other people? In the last 6 months, there's been a flurry of newspaper articles discussing these contract cheaters, shadow scholars, talking about them as a problem. The Daily Mail has sent reporters out to Kenya to look at the fact that they complete work for NHS doctors and NHS nurses. Of course, the other side of that is who are the academics who are procuring this work? The shadow scholars are actually the people who have the best insight into who these people are, because they're able to obtain very personal information about some of their clients. The people who they write for, sometimes they're in very close professional relationships with them for 3 years, because if you're writing someone's PhD thesis, you have to know that person quite well. So that's one area. The other area is looking at drugs and medicines. There are growing concerns around the authenticity of lots of drugs and medicines. WHO has been spending lots of time trying to shore up confidence and provide lots of guidance as to how you can tell, but there's currently no comprehensive field level test that will tell us whether drug A is 100% authentic. They think it's going to be about 3 to 4 years before we're able to get that level of confidence in any of the devices that test the authenticity of drugs. So in the meantime, what do we do? One of the things I'm really interested in is looking at how do people who have to dispense medicines in contexts where they're concerned about their authenticity make decisions as to what they can give patients. If we think about the packaging of fake medicines, one of the things that's really astonishing when you speak to frontline workers is they're able to tell through intuition and experience a fake from a real drug by the packaging, because the fake packaging is so much better than the real one. The holograms, the amount that's invested in how it looks. I've spoken to people who've said they've set fire to or they've disposed of drugs that they thought just looked a bit too good. On the one hand, you think, great, but actually often these drugs are in a place that they're really needed. So can you afford to go on just your gut that something looks a little bit too good? This is the kind of uncomfortable ethical space we're finding ourselves in, where all of the things that we use to give us confidence about something, where something comes from, our relationships, our experience, it's getting increasingly confused. Although my work is looking at health and medicine, I think it really resonates with other fields. And we have to think about how we're going to reconcile this collectively. I don't think any one field necessarily has the answer to this. The project is really trying to understand how do we make sense of these concerns around the fake, given that we have been told the 21st century is going to be defined as the crisis of authenticity. Of course, there have been other times in history when people have been concerned about authenticity. What we have now that magnifies those concerns is technology like the internet. That means real or fake concerns spread. Real or fake goods can move very fast. I can fly without having a tangible ticket. How do we all live with all of these concerns around fake news, around fake certificates, around fake personas that people present online? How do we actually make our decisions? And I think what the project is trying to do is to get us to think through that together and look at how other people deal with these very complex questions. I thought it'd be interesting to hear about how the genuine fake crops up in other fields. So in July 2019, I hosted a workshop at Somerville College, Oxford. This brought together people from very different areas to discuss the genuine fake. I wanted to really capture the conversations, the insights from the workshop. And so that was the inspiration for this podcast series. I hope you enjoy listening. Thank you.